Now, since taking to the stage in 1996, it has won a staggering 28 awards on both sides of the Atlantic and is now almost universally accepted as one of the most profoundly moving dance works ever seen. So here to discuss the show's enormous success, would you please welcome choreographer Matthew Bourne and lead dancer Adam Cooper. Nice to see you both. Been queuing up all morning to get in, I tell you. But Matthew, it is so innovative, and obviously it's been so well received, and just so different. What gave you the idea initially?
Well, I knew if I was going to do a new version of Swan Lake, which is such a sort of hallowed piece, that I would have to wipe away the images that are in people's minds of Swan Lake, which is tutus and the ballerinas and point shoes and everything. So I thought I had to do something quite radical, and so the idea of casting men as swans seemed to do that very appropriately, and it also had other. There were other reasons. It's when I watched swans, I felt that they had a more masculine look to them somehow. They're very strong. They're very. The wingspan is enormous. They're powerful. They're also quite ungainly out of the water. Not that male dancers are ungainly, but but you know, I thought I could play with that. And the other reason was I felt that. By having male swans and still having a prince, that it threw up a lot of psychological sort of interesting things about alter egos and missing father figures and the fact that the prince doesn't have a lot of love in his life, and the swan began to represent all sorts of things to him, the person that he couldn't be.
And, of course, open to interpretation by the audience.
Oh, very much. But we welcome that.
So, Adam, you were at the Royal Ballet, if I remember correctly.
That's right.
So when you heard of this idea, from a traditional dancer's point of view, what did you think of it?
Well,
be honest.
I will. initially, I thought the idea of updating Swan Lake was something that was long overdue. I mean, I love the classical version, but having done it for 8 or 9 years, I was getting a bit bored of it. And having seen Matthew's work as well, I knew that what he would do would be fantastic and would be very true to the score of Tchaikovsky. But when he told me I was going to be the swan, I suddenly thought, well, is there a prince? Is there a princess? you know, and I was a bit sceptical at first. But as soon as we started talking about it in more detail, I knew
and
that.
And were any of your friends in the Royal Ballet, were they equally sceptical when you said you were going to do it?
They were, yeah. And some of them actually refused to come and watch it because they just thought the whole idea of it was disgusting, and how could somebody do this to Swan Lake? Which, you know, I mean, fair enough if that's the way, if they're that narrow-minded that they can't even come and have a look to see what we've done. I mean, somebody actually came up to me and said, well, what's he calling it? And I said, well, Swan Lake, of course. It's Swan Lake. He was like, oh, well, how can you do that? I mean, it's just ridiculous. But I mean, I
like the way you push the boundaries of dance, because, I mean, all over the world now, you only have to look at Irish dancing, the way river dancers push the boundaries of that. Mm. It seems to be a really good time for just appealing to a wider audience, if you like.
Well, definitely. I think also it's telling stories as well. It really appeals to a wider audience. And that's one of the things we've tried to do with this piece is to demystify dance in some ways, and ballet in particular, which, you know, Adam and I are great fans of course, but a lot of people don't understand it or are frightened by it, feel as though you need a lot of knowledge to be able to appreciate it. So we try and sort of tell a story that everyone can follow and identify with. So that was one of the reasons why it's so popular, I think.
Well, just watching you in action there does lead us to the point of how people perceive the whole thing. I mean, some people perceive it as a gay ballet, mm-hmm. and I suppose other people might have perceived it as going to be blokes and drag. So yeah, how did you deal with that?
Well, it's strange because people can't quite imagine what it's going to look like, however many images they see or whatever. They can't imagine that it's the part where it's the swan sections of it are going to be the serious bits. They think it's going to be a send-up. And I think most people think, oh, it's going to be a great giggle, it's going to be a laugh. And actually the swan sections are where it sort of turns serious in a sense. And I think it's one of those things you have to experience, really. People do take it in many different ways. I mean, there is a prince and there's a male swan and there is some sort of relationship there that develops, but it can be so many things. So it's not, I wouldn't say it wasn't a gay Swan Lake, but I also wouldn't say it was. So,
well, of course, as the girls were saying right here, it doesn't matter because they quite like looking at the blokes.
Well, exactly.
You know, good-looking blokes stripped to the waist, so there you go.
Yes.
Actually, I mean, you've given up the Royal Ballet to tour with this. Mm. I mean, have you ever had any regrets at all about, you know, giving up the very traditional side of it?
Not at all. I mean, I actually have done some ballet since, so it's not that I've given it up completely. But I just find the audience that we attract with this show is just fantastic, and kind of my profile has gone up amazingly since doing it. So, I mean, this show has just been fantastic for me from the beginning.
Well, all those awards on Broadway and here can't be wrong, so it's a great accolade. Now, listen, before you leave today, I have to ask Matthew, I love this story, because I hear down the grapevine that you were a bit of a stage door Johnny in your time, and particularly at the BBC. So paint the scene for me at the BBC.
Well, I'd been an autograph collector in my youth, and when I first started work, because I came to dance very late, I had a very series of very dreary jobs. One of them was filing at the BBC, and I used to, to keep up my autograph collecting, I used to pretend that I was the greeter for the Pete Murray show. Had a great radio show in those days with lots of guests, very high-profile guests. And I used to go down in my lunchtime and greet them from their cars and say that I was there to meet them, to take them to the studio. So we had nice little chats and little signatures were given. Bette Midler, Sly Stallone and people like that. So it was fun.
And so the commissioner didn't stop you? He sort of just regarded that you were the greeter?
I think he just thought that's what I was there for, really. Nobody seemed to notice.
I think that's fact. That show was called Open House as well.
That's right.
It was. And ironically enough, I got my job in Radio 2 because I used to think that that was a fab programme and, you know, that was my niche, and I ended up doing it in a way, that niche. And here we are in Open House, so it's all gone the full circle for you. So how long, just very briefly, are you in the West End for?
It's just another 4 weeks now. 4 weeks. And really is strictly limited. We're going on a European tour following that, so...
But it's not true that we'll never ever see it again back here, is it?
Well, we've no plans to, but I'm sure it will re-emerge.
I'm sure it will. It's a huge success. Thank you both very much indeed for joining us today. Matthew and Adam, thank you.
Thank you.